So I have not heard from Rachel. I have not heard from Kirsten. Hear our praises, the format of it. Hi, Kirsten, are you here? Okay, please just get here quickly. Thank you. I'll see you in a few. Okay. Can you have her mics are out there, mics are ready to go. Just wonderful. Hunky dory, where is Danny?
Absolutely dead.
You don't say that when I said, where is Danny?
Danny who?
You have to have time for that. We need a guitar player. Actually, you want to play a guitar player?
Okay, good morning. Great to have you all out this morning. Did your seat warmers work? No, I guess not everyone has seat warmers. Okay, it's good for you to be in the house of God this morning with us, and we just have a great service here from Pastor Scibelli. Just a couple things. Bible College is coming, as you can see behind me, with the graphic there. This is the winter semester, spring semester. It'll be spring by the time the semester ends. And you should know that right now, online registration is fully active. In-person registration comes up on January 17th and 19th, beginning at 6 o'clock. That's a Tuesday and a Thursday, a week from Tuesday and Thursday. And then classes begin on January 23rd. If you'd like to try it out, the first week is open. The first week of classes is an open house, and you can be a part of Bible College that week beginning January 23rd. Another opportunity for you to learn is beginning next Sunday at 5 o'clock here in Classroom 2. If you would like to learn sign language, beginning sign language taught by Woody Pittman will be leading that. That will be in Classroom 2, 5 o'clock beginning. It goes from January 15th through April 30th. So that's a beginner sign language classes with Woody. All right? All right, would you stand, please? Okay, we want to remember Pastor Foster in Florida. He has been hospitalized, and we just want to remember him right now. And I think they said they got 2.5 feet of snow in Turkey, which is like pretty amazing. You know what 2 inches of snow does to Baltimore, right? Yeah, you guys know that. Yeah. Mock. It's okay. It's all right. But imagine that in Turkey. So, all right. Lord, we just pray for Pastor Foster. We lift him to you right now, Lord. We just think of him and his family there and the congregation there. Just really bless him, Lord. And we pray for all those in Turkey and Pastor Roger Robbins there. He was looking forward to traveling to Poland this week to be with Pastor Schaller as he's there ministering. Lord, we pray for Pastor Schaller, his time in Europe. Pastor Scibelli's travels, which begin this week to Africa. Pastor Love, still in Russia. We just thank you. And us here in Baltimore, we just thank you for this service this morning. We ask that you would warm our hearts, Lord. Help us to rejoice in you, Lord, and just anoint this pulpit and this time together. Amen.
Good morning, family. Good to see you. Why don't you greet one another and say hi, get reacquainted.
May our light shine in the
glory fill the whole earth. As the water of the sea, from the mountain to the valley, hear our praises rise to cry of all believers, the one word that we all speak the same, hallelujah, to our Savior. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. We love you.
You choose the humble and raise them high. You choose the weak and make them strong. You heal our brokenness inside and give us life. The same love that set the captives free, the same love that opened eyes to see, is calling us all by name. You are calling us all by name. The same God that spread the heavens wide, the same God who was crucified, is calling us all by name. You are calling us all by name.
You take the faithless one aside and speak the words. You are blind. You call the cynic and the proud. Come to me.
To the cross, you're calling, you're
Lord. Calvary, Lord, thank you, where the world is crucified unto us, where we are crucified unto the world. Thank you, Lord. What a God. What a God we have that's done everything for us. And Father, you simply ask us to agree with you. That's all this morning. You just say, will you agree with me for what I've done for you? That's all. Thank you, Father.
Who is this light invading our darkness? Glorious light, the sun rises before us, conquering night. He captures the hardest of tenderly
who is a God like unto our God? Courageous, courageous, relentless, brave, almighty, tender, compassionate. So kind. Lord, your kindness leads us to change our minds. Your kindness has made us great. Your gentleness, Lord. This is our God this morning. Lord, thank you. We worship you. We praise you. There is none like you. There is no one that loves us the way you love us. No one. Nothing can separate us from your love, Father. Nothing can separate us from this love, God. We worship you. We praise you. Thank you. This is our God. This is our God. We worship no other God. Father, have your way. Speak to us through your Holy Spirit this morning. We need you, Father. We need you, Lord Jesus Christ. In your precious name, amen. Amen.
Wow. It was a great time of just worship and praise. Good morning. This is the offering. So if our ushers could get ready to receive our offering. And Luke 17, there's an amazing story about 10 leopards. And I was reading this portion of scripture and just amazed because all 10 had a need. The need was they were lepers. And all 10 cried out to God. And it says, as they were going, they were all healed. So 10 had a need, 10 cried out to God, 10 were healed. Okay. But it says that, verse 15, one of them, when he saw he was healed, turned back and with a loud voice glorified God. And he fell down on his feet, verse 16, giving him thanks. And this word, giving him thanks, means he responded to the grace of God. The grace of God healed all 10. The grace of God had compassion on all 10. But only one returned. And there's amazing, it says, he was a Samaritan. And then Jesus says this, were there not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? And just thinking about in the offering, you know, our finances, like we have needs, we ask, pray to God, and God meets our needs. But oftentimes we can easily be captivated in the fact that he met our needs, and we just go our way. But it's amazing when we have an attitude of responding to the grace of God and coming back and saying, Lord, you met my needs, but like the leper, he had even a greater need, and that need was, like, he was healed physically, but when he came back and worshiped and glorified God, then he was healed spiritually. And that's an amazing principle, and I was just captivated with that. So as we think of the offering, this is 2017, we're expecting great things from God this year. But a great opportunity that God gives us every service is to worship him with our giving. The very thing he gave to us, we give back to him in an attitude of thanksgiving and praise. So with that this morning, let's give. Let's give to God who has abundantly poured out to each one of us. Maybe not always monetarily, but we have a place we come to. We have a pastor, teacher. We are fed the word of God. We have body life. And this last thing, we went out soul winning yesterday down at the market, and Pastor Scibelli and I, and we were giving out tracts, and there were two individuals. Many people received, but two said, you know what? Thank you for what you're doing. Thank you for giving me a tract. Thank you for stopping me in my progress and telling me how much God cares for me. Amazing. God loves when we pour out to him what he's poured out to us. So with that, let's just pray. Father, thank you this morning. Lord, we have received so much. You have poured out mercy and compassion on each one of us. You have given us our finances. And this morning in the offering, we have an opportunity to worship you in our giving, to freely give back in an attitude of thanksgiving to the grace of God, which you've poured out to us. Lord, our needs are great because we know the call and vision you've placed on our local assembly, a local church with a worldwide vision. Our pastor this morning is ministering in Poland and also in Finland. Pastor Love is in Russia this morning, pouring out to the saints. So Lord, with this offering, be glorified. And we ask it in Jesus' name, amen.
In the hands of Jesus. Good morning. Good to see you. I'm here to promote Bible College. And isn't that great? Not this coming week, but the following week, we're going to have a week-long intensified master's program class that is open for anyone to sit in audit. It's going to be pretty much all morning from 8:30 till lunchtime, and then in the evening, every evening next week. So not this Monday, but the following Monday. And then we have that week also our registration Tuesday night and Thursday night. We have an awesome brand new website where you can register for audit or credit online. And so we're just getting geared up. We just ask you to pray for us. And I had an interesting thing happen to me. I was taking an international student to a dentist appointment. It was down on North Avenue. And this secretary was just shining when we went in there. And I could tell just by looking at her that she was a believer. And she knew that I was from my Maryland Bible College and Seminary, so we started fellowshipping. What church do you go to? So I said, Greater Grace, World Outreach. She goes, that's my church. I've been going there for 3 years. And she goes, we have a Bible college? I said, yes, we do. And it just shows you that some people might not know what happens here semester after semester. This PM. Pam Greaves from China. Hey, Pam, I love you. So that's just amazing to just be praying. If you knew about it, if you don't know about it, just check out our new website, and we're looking forward to seeing you this semester. Amen.
All right, would you stand, please? We're going to read from the scriptures here, and then Pastor Scibelli is going to preach. All right, are you ready? Seat belts prepared? All right. All right, Ephesians 2, Ephesians 2, Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. And you hath he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sin, wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past, in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, has quickened us together with Christ. By grace, you are saved. Let's pray. So, Lord, thank you for these great words. Lord, we thank you for the scriptures and for the authority of their message for all of our lives and for the life of the whole, all of creation, Lord, all that they mean to us, Lord. We thank you for bringing us together this morning to hear from this passage, Lord. We ask you to anoint Pastor Scibelli today, Lord. We just think of our work around the world as a ministry. Pastor Love in Russia, Pastor Schaller today in Finland and Poland this week, Pastor Scibelli's travels to Africa. Lord, we just thank you for churches like this one in Baltimore, throughout America, opening the Word of God throughout the world, speaking the truth in love, Lord. We thank you for your Holy Spirit, Lord. Drawing us together as members in particular. Lord, we thank you for your presence in this place this morning. Really, open our hearts, Lord, and quicken our minds. Lord, renew us, Lord, into a right spirit. Give us the garment of praise for our heaviness, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We know these words are faithful and true. Amen.
You may be seated. Thank you. Pam Greaves was, she made sure that I ate well in China. It was always there with something that was eatable. Not everything is always eatable. People eat things, but not everything is, for everybody, always eatable. So she was a great help on my trip to China, and I really enjoyed that. Still can't figure out how to use chopsticks, but
you know, they're good for something, I guess. So. Anyway, it's nice out today, isn't it? My wife says, "Where's your jacket?" I said, "Never worn one. Don't wear jackets." Just anyway, we thank God. We're praying for Pastor Schaller. And Pastor Roger called me this morning. People overseas never know what time it is. "Hi, how you doing?" Like, you know, you're barely, like, thinking. And he said they have 2.5 feet of snow in Turkey. And he said, "And it's still snowing." I said, "There's nothing here." He said, he's praying he's going to Poland on Monday to be with Pastor Schaller. So pray that the airports function and they move. So in this portion of Scripture, incredible portion. And by the way, we have a baptism at 11 o'clock for those of you that would desire to stay. But this is an amazing portion of Scripture. And if you look at the first three verses, it's kind of like a six-point indictment against the believer or the system, the world, and the devil. It starts off by saying, "And you who were dead in trespasses and sins." Did you know, and do I know, that I was dead in something? In trespasses and sins? We were dead in trespasses and sins. Sins is falling short of the glory of God. Trespasses is a willful decision to step over the line. There's quite a difference there. We were dead in falling short. Sin is falling short of the glory of God, missing the mark. Kind of like a mistake, a miss, a sin. But trespasses is a willful stepping over the line. And he's and the writer here, through the inspiration of the Spirit, says, we were dead in trespasses and sins. Then it says, we walked according to the course of this world. And that's amazing. Is that up there behind me? It'd be awesome if it was. 2:1-3. Huh? Look at that. Okay, where in time, we forgot the first verse. It's okay. Where in time past you walked according to the course of this world. That's an interesting statement. According to the aeon of the cosmos, according to the system that is opposed to God. So, by the way, time past is something, isn't it? Aren't you glad time past is past? Time past. He says it 4 times in this portion of Scripture, along with verses 11 and 12. Time past. New year. New person. Time past. Time past. So walk according to the course of this world. In other words, first of all, we're dead in trespasses and sins. Number two, we have a walk or a lifestyle. The word walk is a lifestyle according to the course of this world, the way the world lives. Then it says, according to the prince of the power of the air, that's Satan. According to that's number three. That's 3-point indictment. According to the prince of the power of the air. What's next? The spirit, and that actually translates in the Amplified Bible, the demon spirits that now work in the children of disobedience. Now, don't go on calling your disobedient children demons, okay? Hey, I'm just saying this is what this says, okay? The children of disobedience. So that's number four. What's number five? Can you give me another verse here? Okay. Among whom also we all had our conversation or our life in times past in the lust of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind. So we had, lust means not just as we often think about it in one way, but lust means how I think, the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind. We have an old sin nature of flesh, and it's the spirit is against the flesh and the flesh against the spirit. Then number six, we were by nature, we were born children of wrath. We have an old sin nature. What a mess, isn't it? I mean, like, and I was looking at that yesterday. I thought, what a mess I was, and I still could be, okay? What a mess, James Bryson, huh? Pastor Eugene said we met somebody, two people that thanked us for, one was a pastor, and he said, "I'm so thankful for what your church does. Pray for my church that we could begin to do the same." But then we met another person, and that person was a little bit outraged. You didn't mention that person, huh? You're being Mr. Nice, you know? And that person was yelling and shouting and screaming, you know, about get out of here. What are you doing here? Passing out. We don't want to hear about God, you know, something like that. It's amazing how when you enter darkness with light, how people can react. But this is amazing. So here we are as individuals. You know, do you ever meet people and they just say, like, I'm a good person? Read that. Read that. You're a good person? Read that. There's a sixfold count against a person, humanity, people. All right, I don't care who they are. The best person in the world. That's true of them and true of me. All right? In time past. It's really interesting. Then there comes two of the, I think, the greatest words in the Bible. You know what they are? But God. But God. And think about that. Those are two amazing words. The word is deitheos, and it means a transition. Something's going to change. But God. But God. If you had ever known Pastor Cooper before But God came in, I mean, are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? That the New Jersey, New York stuff? No. I'm just having fun. Okay. But God. All right? But God. And really, this is amazing. But God. And this is what is a possibility in the truth of God's nature for every single one of us and in our daily lives now, not just when we got saved, but in our daily lives now, we are in situations, and they don't look so good all the time. Am I right? We've got financial issues, health issues, atmospheric issues, children issues, family issues, marriage issues. There's all kinds of things that can be going on. And if I just begin to think and concentrate about those things, then I can be overwhelmed by those. Those six could overwhelm any human being. Are you with me? Dead in trespasses and sins, right? Walking according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the demon spirits that work in the children of disobedience, fulfilling the lusts and the desires of the flesh, by nature children of wrath. Huh, you look at that. That's called bad news. It really is good news because it tells me where I am without Christ. Are you with me? Then the amazing transformation takes place, but God, right? But God. I think you've had some children maybe in Christian school at times, and you kind of look at those six things, and then you go, but God, right? Pastor Barry, but God, but God. I was thinking this morning about some students from Springfield Christian School. Let me give you a few names. These maybe you don't know them, but they were... I know them, and I was just thinking about them and praying about them. It's amazing. Penny Parker, who is now Penny Pierce, she went to China. She was in the 12th grade. That was my 11th grade was my last class there. Latasha Brown, who spends a lot of time in Africa. Michelle Cabral, who went to Chile. Avril Bates, at the time, became Avril Plunkett, and she went to China. Mike Plunkett. If there was ever anybody I thought would never do a whole lot, it was Mike Plunkett. He was a tough character, tough kid, you know. He could be 13 years old and try to take you out on the basketball court, you know. Jimmy Shermer, Pastor Jim Shermer, was in that class. He's in Budapest, Hungary. Am I missing any? Debbie Wistera. Wow, Pete Wistera owes me. Debbie Wistera. Carlos Serino, right? I mentioned Michelle Cabral, right? Lisa, I mean, it was amazing. See, when you look at some things by sight or people, you sometimes you can see someone in those six things, or in one of them, or two of them, or whatever, you know? And then you begin to say, what's going to happen, you know? And you look at it and you think, can that person ever change? But we forget the two what? We forget the two words, but God. But God comes in. You know, I can tell you a story that happened in the early 80s. How many years ago is that? 33? Yeah, 33 years ago. I was really involved in the church, in the ministry. I was in Bible school. I had somewhat finished Bible school and was kind of convinced about what my ministry was going to be and what I was going to do. I worked in prisons, three of them, in Massachusetts. One a prison for all murderers. That's always fun when there's no death sentence. Kill you is no big deal in the prison, you know. They're already there for their life. And I had it all figured out, you know, working with alcoholics and drug addicts and people that have real severe problems. And one day at Starreton Chapel, we had this little chapel on Eastern States Exposition grounds, and it was a very old chapel. It was something, was like a relic, a historic site. And they said one day that somebody named Pastor Schaller was coming to preach. Now, I had about as much interest in missions as I do, you know, in hanging around whatever, evil people, all right? I had no interest at all. When I would think about missions, I would actually, sometimes I would mock it in my mind. Oh, come on, whatever, you know? So when he came to preach, I decided to go up in the balcony. And the church was down there, and we had a balcony that could hold about 30 people. I went up in the balcony, and I sat behind the pole. Like, can I get as far away from this so there'll be no influence in regards to missions? Because I'm going to deal with people, with problems. I was on the streets. It was a street ministry. This is what I'm going to do the rest of my life. Got it all figured out, don't you? Everything's figured out. So I'm up there, kind of sitting there fiddling with my Bible, and he starts to preach from Hebrews 11, verse 1. My memory doesn't fail me on that one. And I'll tell you, it was like a lightning bolt hit me between the eyes. And God called me to missions right there. I'm like out of there. I'm running away. And he's just there, and it was an amazingly powerful, anointed message. And he was preaching, the place was, I think you used to have to get up on top, remember? That we had that thing where Sky used to sing with Leslie all the time, right? And it was like, how far away can I get? Because I want nothing to do with missions. Now, none of you have ever thought that, have you? Got my life carved out. Huh? I'm the potter and God's the clay. I'm going to make him exactly how I'd like to. And I'm going to make sure that he makes it easy for me the way I want it. Because I'm the planner. As a matter of fact, I can even do better than the devil. I can enter into the entire Trinity. I'll be the Father. I'll be the Son who executes the plan. And I'll be the Holy Spirit that tells everybody all about it. Yeah, I'm Trinitarian. I become Trinitarian as a human being. But that message woke up my spirit. Amen? It woke my spirit. You know what it was? It was simply, but God. Okay? He was concentrating on, and now faith is. He kept saying, now faith is. Now faith is. And I'm going, no, no, no. You can only say no for so long. Right, Texas, Greg? Yeah. You can only say no to Texas for so long. And I'm just having fun with you. But God. But God comes in. And so we look at our situations at times in life, and we evaluate them, and we pray about them, and we think about them, and we live in them, and yet all it would take is one simple thing to happen. But God. Are you with me? But God. I mean, people get saved in a moment of time. But God. God comes in. You could see a wayward teenager or a wayward child going their own way. And you begin to ask, and by the way, these could be wayward children that are 20, 30, 40, 50 years old for some of us. Okay? And you think about that. And we look at it, and simply by praying and believing God and just saying, this is the situation. You know, have you ever said, nothing's going to change this? Huh? Nothing's going to change this person. Nothing's going to change this situation but God. Transition takes place. Something new happens. This is what but God means, de theos. It doesn't just the word in the English language, but it means a change is taking place. That person that had no interest in God now has a desire to walk with God. that teenager that was so difficult to handle, and I've had a bunch of them in my life, all of a sudden, because of but God, they have been transformed, and some of them are missionaries and working on the field, but God. That person living in idolatry, I heard a story from Watchman Nee, and he talked about somebody, a mother, who took her little son to a cave to worship an idol. You got that, Jim Markowski? Worship an idol. And as he was standing there next to his mother, he said to himself, how could God be in this dirty idol? How could God be in this dirty idol? And the boy remembered this because when he met Watchman Nee and Watchman Nee evangelized him, he said, this is the second time I've met God. First time I met him was in that cave. I didn't know who he was or what was going on, but now I know. See, God came in and changed his life. But God. So we can look at situations that are going on, whether we're in this world, whatever's taking place anywhere, and then God comes in. And we simply say, but God. And this is what Paul said to the Ephesians. This is a mess. Dead in trespasses and sins, willful disobedience, walking according to the course of this world that is alienated from and opposed to God. Are you listening? According to the prince of the power of the air who controls the world. No, the American president doesn't control the world. Satan does. That's 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4, if you don't believe it. Hello? It's amazing. Walking according to the lusts and desires of the flesh and of the mind and by nature children of wrath. You go, oh, what? This is unbelievable. But God comes in. Are you with me? God comes in, but God. And that's amazing. Here's another verse that goes so well with it. The wages of sin is what?
Yeah, yeah. What's the next word?
But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. The wages of sin is death. You want to leave people there with that gospel? Walk around all day saying the wages of sin is death. Wages of sin is death. I've heard people in Africa doing that at times. You know, wages of sin is death. It's all they shout about is sin and death. They forget the second part of the verse. But, transition, change, something new take place. But the gift of God is what? Eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. That's amazing. How about this one? I was thinking about this one this morning. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of love, power, and a sound mind. Wow, a transition takes place. A change is going on. Look at us. We were walking in the garden with God, and Satan deceived us. We sinned, and now we're hiding and using fig leaves, and we're hiding and running away from God. End of story? Is that the end of the story? Come on. Shouldn't be sleeping on Sunday morning. But God. Here comes God with skins. But God. Adam and Eve are clothed with skins. But God. Look at Abraham's life. The things that he did and what went on in his life when he came out from the Ur of the Chaldeans and how he tried to make things happen with Ishmael and all that went on. And you know what the answer to Abraham's life is? But God. But God. God was faithful to Abraham. And so we look through the scriptures. We think about Jacob. Trickster, schemer, supplanter, liar, deceiver. What a mess he was. Go to Bible school. You'll learn about him. Pastor Glenn said. But something happened in Genesis 32 at the Ford Jabbok. He went over the Ford Jabbok, and he wrestled with God, and he was changed forever. Is that possible? Hello? Hello, 9 o'clock. Hello? Huh? Changed forever. His name became Israel, one who has power with God. How can you change Jacob? I like how God put him under Laban, who was worse than him. God has a sense of humor. I read something from Watchman Nee yesterday. He said, did you ever notice how God puts people in your path that relate to you the same way you relate to God? Like if I'm impatient, he puts impatient people around me. If I'm holding back, he'll put people that hold back around me. He puts the, just to lovingly discipline us, he puts people we in contacts in our lives that are just the same relating to us as we relate to God. I thought that's amazing. That's amazing. How God does it in such a loving, wonderful, gentle way to get my attention. Are you with me? But God, what a mess. 17 years old, sold into Egypt. What can come out of this? The greatest missionary movement in the history of the Bible. One 17-year-old boy goes down, and why? Because of but God, he comes out 2.5 million people. What happened? God placed Joseph in Egypt. He could think about, you know, have you ever thought that somebody sold you out? Oh, my God. They were so close to me. They were my best friend. They were my brother. They were my blood relative. How could this happen? You know how? But God. But God. By the way, expect those things. Jesus was real popular in his hometown. They tried to throw him off a cliff. But the Father, okay? But God. But God. Hey, you, the deliverer, you're a murderer. Exodus 2. By the way, he didn't just kill an Egyptian. He killed him and hit him in the sand. He's a grave digger, too. Moses was a murderer and a grave digger. Okay? What happened? James Bryson, what happened? But God came in. God called him. God called him. And the gift and calling of God without God changing his mind. And we can look at people and situations in life and take a look at it from a natural viewpoint through human understanding and reason, but we forget about two simple words. What are they? But God. But God comes in. How are we going to get through the Red Sea? We can't swim. We're not swimmers. Look at this. Egyptians are behind us. Water's in front of us. Right and left are mountains. What are we going to do? How about but God? How about God opens up your Red Sea? Do you have a Red Sea? Are you facing a Red Sea? Ever faced a Red Sea? All of a sudden, it opens up and they go through on dry ground. That's called what? But God. Got a financial issue in your life. Things look horrible financially. Yeah. What are you going to do, meditate on that? Going to meditate on horror? Like a horror film or something with Vincent Price? Some of you that are older remember that stuff. But God! But God, I'm not going to think about that. I'm going to know it's there, but I'm going to be looking to God for a but God. When we started the Children of Grace, we had 3 orphans. Now we have 288. Don't ask me how. Don't ask me where they came from. Don't ask me what the provision is. All I know is 2 words. What are they? But God. But God. Paul says, but God was rich in mercy for the great love wherewith he loved us. By grace we are saved. Think about those 3 things. Love, mercy, and grace. Don't you love it? Aren't those awesome? Love, unconditional, eternal, unending. Mercy, rejoicing over judgment. Grace, God's nature and character towards me. You can look at this person and say, oh, we've never gotten along. This marriage will never work. These kids will never turn out. But you've forgotten about 2 words. What? But God. Doesn't say but you. Doesn't say but me. Doesn't say but Trump. Doesn't say but government. Doesn't say but, you know, whatever. What's that where they have the every day, the all the companies and everything. Wall Street, but Wall Street. But the economy. But better weather. But a geographical change. But new friends. Huh? But having more better health. No, but God. But God. And Satan loves to take away and steal from people the simplicity of the gospel. And you can tell me about a situation and I'm just going to believe, but God. But God. Are you with me? But God. We're going to have a baptism today. I was going to tell the story at 11 o'clock. Maybe I will too, but we were baptizing somebody in Liberia, and this was like, this can happen anywhere, but they went down into the water, a person, and they came out something different. They came out of the water, and it was like a demon. And I was like, I wasn't in the water too close because it was so murky, and I didn't know what was in that water, but the Pastor Alfred and some of the Liberians and Pastor John Jason, they were in the water. They put the person down, and what came out was something very unusual. And I took a couple steps back further. And Pastor John Jason, who you know, he comes here every year, he just put his hand on this little girl and said, come out of her. He didn't like scream and holler and whatnot, just come out of her. And it was gone. Then we led her to Christ and baptized her. That was amazing. But God, how can these things change? What can take place? Simply understanding. I'm on the road to Damascus. I have a mission to destroy the church. Oh, really? That's really cute. That's really nice, and I don't think you're going to be too successful. You know why? Something's going to happen on that road, and the sky's going to open up, and I am Jesus whom you persecute, and all of a sudden, Saul became who? Paul. How did that happen? But God. But God. This is so amazing. But God in China. But God in India. I was talking with two people yesterday. Both had their brothers pass away this week. Pastor Carl in India and Pastor Clyde in the Philippines. And they both lost brothers in the same week. You know what? When you face situations, so often there's just a loss of words. There's not much to say. All you can say is, but God. But God can come in. Can God comfort somebody? Hello? Can God take away their sorrow with his joy? Can God minister to people? Can God change situations? Can God work being confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ? Can God change your husband? You can't. Can God change your wife? God change your kids. God change your health? Hmm? But God. No, I'm not again. I go to doctors if I have to. Don't like them very much. They've always got some kind of crazy advice. I've had doctors tell me things you got to do this right away. Oh, really? That's so cute. If it was up to you, I'd have a new heart or something or whatever, you know, or take this out. I learned my lesson early in a certain country, and they said, you immediately were rushing you in to the emergency surgery place. We're going to take out your appendix. I said, really? I said, I think you're going to wait because I have to agree to this. And what I had was a kidney stone. Well, guess what? God was right and they were wrong. But what? But God. But God, we pray, can God heal? How about you got 6,600 demons in you in Mark chapter 5. Doesn't look like a very good deal, does it? Huh? How does it change? But God. They all come out and becomes a preacher. Isn't that amazing? 10 cities. A woman with an issue of blood. All of her money on all physicians, and she just does what? She touches the garment of Jesus, but God. And she's changed. Jairus' daughter has died. And Jesus says she's just sleeping. And they're laughing. You know what? Even carnal Christians laugh at God's ability to perform miracles. They do. Why? Because we have so much in this life, and we have so much available, and we're so technologically advanced that simply just believing God for something very unusual. Can God take away cancer? Yes. Heart disease, heart problems, all kinds of things. But no, kind of like God would be the last one I go to. I'm doing this through my own mind. This person says this. This person says that. That doctor says this. This doctor says that. The physician says this. My mother says that. My father says that. What about God? What about God? Can God change a person? Can an addiction go? Oh, yeah. Any addiction. Smoking? Oh, yeah. I'm not condemning anybody. I'm just saying. Can you be delivered? Pastor Steve Murillo got delivered from smoking in 1 second in Morocco. I'm not going to tell you the story because it's kind of unusual and a little bit embarrassing. But he got delivered from smoking. Just like that. He also got delivered from heroin. You can get delivered from alcohol. You can be delivered from pornography in a second. Why? Because of but God. And if I don't believe that, I entertain all kinds of thoughts that come from the world and the atmosphere and my old sin nature, and I begin to think to myself, this will never happen. This can't happen. I won't say it because I'm a Christian phraseology person that's going to always say, oh, yeah, God can do it. But in my mind, do I really believe that? God can call somebody into some area in life, some mission field, in something in the ministry, but God. How about Bible school? I could never go to Bible school. I don't know if I could understand this. Somebody told me that this week. I said, what's there to understand? Just listen to the Word of God and watch what God will do in you. You're looking at learning based upon how you spent your life learning, and it was frustrated because you were learning in the world. But this is learning through Christ. This is learning through the Spirit. This is learning eternal Bible. How about just saying, I'm going to Bible school because of but God? But God. Don't think I've been in countries where people are illiterate and they graduated from Bible school. But God. We have two blind graduates in Togo, both 4 years. Say, how did they do that? They are great hearers, and then they would do the test because they had amazing hearing and listening skills, and they passed the tests, and they graduated from Bible school, and they couldn't see, and they're pastoring a church, him and his wife both blind. They're pastoring a 50-person church in Togo. You know what the answer is? But God. But God. And I don't want to overemphasize that little two words, but I am. Why? Because I know I will face situations and circumstances today and tomorrow and the next week and the next week, and it's all but God. We were upside down on an airplane once. Thank you, Pastor Eugene. I'm serious. We were traveling from Uganda to the Sudan, and all of a sudden the plane was upside down. Have you ever been in one of those babies? And I'm thinking, like, this is it. What a way to go. Landing, crashing in Uganda where no one will ever find you again. Can't even have a decent funeral. And we, some of us were praying out of fright. God! That's when there's like, I think there were 7 of us on the plane. I hate small planes. You know, like British, I travel a lot, but like those 7 passenger deals, anything can happen. Anything can happen. You know what happened? The guy turned it back around. And I disciplined him when I got off the plane, the pilot. I said, you are sick. He goes, what happened to your faith? I thought you were a Christian. I said, I have faith in God, not you. But God. When we look at our lives, how am I going to grow? Well, I'm going to give you a great verse, 2 Peter 3:18, but grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. He talks about all the situations in the world and how wicked it is. He says, but grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. As you go through the scriptures, how does Peter make it? You want to hear how he makes it? Simon, Simon, Satan has desired to have you that he might sift you like wheat. But I have prayed for you. But I have prayed for you that your faith fail not, and when you're converted, strengthen your brethren. God can turn a person around. I don't care if it's a thorn in the flesh, it's a besetting sin, it's a bad habit, it's a pattern in my life, but God comes in. I've always been insecure and quiet. How about but God? I've always been loud and noisy. Yeah, I know. But God can quiet you down. Amen? I've always been afraid, but God with perfect love can take away fear. Amen? I've always, but God. So as we think about the sixfold indictment, we thank God for those two words, but God. So Father, thank you today. How is Ruth going to go up? But God. But God. How can Daniel survive in a lion's den? But God. How about fiery furnace? But God. But God. How about Esther going to the king? But God. But God. But God. How do we deliver somebody from prison? Acts 12. But God. How can 3,000 get saved in Acts? But God. But God. We thank you today for something new to take place. Ephesians chapter 2, 1 and 2 and 11 and 12 says, in time past. What an amazing truth, but God. A transition takes place, a change occurs. God comes in. God comes in. We thank you, but God. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. A prodigal comes home, but God meets him in the pig pen. But God. But God. If you are here this morning, you've never received Christ as your personal Savior. The Bible says that the wages of sin is death. We're not leaving you with that. But the gift of God, the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. You can pray and say, Jesus, save me today. On the internet, save me. Oh, yes, I have sinned. My life is just immersed in sin. But I'm coming up out of that sin because of the gift of eternal life. I say yes to Jesus this morning. I confess him as my Lord and Savior. I believe in who he is and what he's done at the cross, and his blood cleanses me from all sin. I say yes to God. With our eyes closed, our heads bowed, here and on the internet, just put your hand up. Acknowledge Jesus Christ, but God. But God. Thank you, but God. We pray. Help us, God, as we walk with you. All of us are in different situations, circumstances, phases. We pray that we would be a people who would simply remember two words. In our difficulties, in our trials, in our tests, in our opposition, in our families, in our marriage, in our relationships, in the church, living in the country, propagating the gospel, evangelism, Bible school, Christian school, if we could simply remember and not forget, but God, who is rich in mercy and his great love, and we are saved by grace. The divine reversal. You meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. We thank you today. Help us, God. You know intimately our situation, whatever it may be. Maybe fear, insecurity, living in doubt, uncertainty. Really believing God for a calling in my life. But looking at myself will never help. But looking at Jesus and then myself in Christ, that's the answer. But God. But God. We thank you today. Bless our day today. We thank you. The service to come at 11 o'clock, the baptism. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Please stand. Please stand. Thank you. Greater than all we seek.
Okay, before we pray, tonight we have a healing service, praying for the sick, anointing with oil. That will be tonight, and continue this message, but God. But we're going to add, because in verse 13 it says, but now, but God, verse 4, but now, we'll talk about that tonight, but now, in relationship to the world and the church and whatnot. So let's pray. Okay, we want to pray for Alan Trammell that had a collapse this morning, very weak. Family's asking us to pray, so we pray for him. God, just touch him. We thank you. Thank you, God. But God, come in and change. Change in that man's life, God. Just touch him. We thank you. Once again, bless Pastor Schaller and his travels, God, Finland, Poland, and minister through him and to him. Give him strength and wisdom. We thank you for his life, his family. Just touch and move. We pray, God, that you would help us today to just reflect on the message of but God. It's in the Bible. It's the Word. And it's alive and sharp and powerful. That we would not be overwhelmed. But when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Lead me to the rock. That I'm not going to look at situations. I'm going to look at God. And mix faith. Believe God. As Paul, we heard the other night, I believe God, it will be exactly as he told me, Acts 27. So touch us today. Bring us back tonight with a great expectation. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. You are dismissed.